Just 1 minute.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah, we can start now, Matthew.
Okay, great. Hello, everyone. My name is Amit, and I'm the Associate Director of Client Relations for IDP South Asia. I look after UK, Ireland, and New Zealand. And today I am really excited. We have got two eminent speakers from University College Cork, and they are going to talk about importance of health and life sciences in the new COVID world. I don't think we can find a more relevant topic than this in these times when we are trying to come out of the COVID situation. And the comments from Dr. John and Dr. Kelly will be really helpful to give you insights, what you can look forward to as you all possibly looking forward to study in Ireland. If you decide to choose these subjects, I think we have got two of the best experts who will give you insights on the subject. If you have questions, use the chat box or the QA section, and please post your questions. I also have got some colleagues from UCC to take on some questions if there are questions, or they can also answer these questions at a later date. So with this, let me first introduce my first speaker, Dr. John McSharry. Dr. McSharry is a researcher in microbial immunology with focus on the interactions of the host epithelium and microbes in the lung, gut, and urinary tract. He is a BSc in microbiology and a PhD in McSharry immunology from University College Cork. He has worked with Elementary Health Limited, as molecular biology section head, collaborating with several multinational research partners. John was also a postdoctoral researcher with a joint APC GlaxoSmithKline host response core. He was a guest researcher at the Meekins Christie Laboratories, McGill University in Montreal, Canada, as part of the Science Foundation Ireland Fellowship in 2009 and 10. In 2013, he was appointed as a lecturer in molecular medical microbiology and deputy director of the GEM program. With his School of Medicine, with an affiliation to the School of Microbiology, his research interests are in host microbe interactions with particular focus on the immune sampling and response. John has active research projects with academic and industrial partners and currently has active collaborations funded by Nutrica, the known in SFI. Recently, John was funded by SFI to evaluate saliva for screening of COVID-19. I think the insights Dr. John gonna offer will be really, really valuable. My next speaker will be Dr. Kellie Dean, and she's originally from Western Pennsylvania. Dr. Dean graduated with a BSc in chemistry, minor in biology from Indiana University of Pennsylvania, USA. She completed her PhD in biochemistry and biophysics at the University of North Carolina at the Chapel Hill. After moving to Ireland in 2005, she began lecturing part-time at UCC, teaching biochemistry to medicine, dentistry, and pharmacy students. Since 2015, she has been a full-time college lecturer, leading a research group that is focused in understanding the roles and non-coding RNAs. RNAs binding proteins, RNA protein complexes in cancer and other human diseases. Dr. Dean is also director of the MSc in molecular cell biology with bioinnovation and the MREs in biochemistry and cell biology. I think really can't ask for more, as we have took the best speakers from UCC, and in the times which the topic becomes more and more relevant. So over to you, Dr. McSharry and Dr. Kelly, and I'm sure our audiences will definitely benefit a lot today. Thank you for coming in and speaking to these audiences.
Thanks very much, Amit.
Thank you.
I can go first. Dr. Kelly, do you want to go first?
You can go first. I can follow on from you. That's fine. Thanks.
Okay. All right. So I'll just share my screen. So should share And you can just let me know if you can see my screen. I hope you can. Okay, so so thanks very much, Amit. And I suppose apologize for the big long introduction you had to read about me. lots of complicated annotations, but so I'm deputy director of the graduate entry program in medicine as well. So I suppose we do Dr. Dean and myself, we both do a lot of teaching, but we also do a lot of research. And I'm just going to give you a quick flavor of what's happening with COVID-19, you know, from the UCC perspective, and just a bit of it, I suppose, from, you know, how we see things happening in Ireland. And so it's probably quite relevant. And also, I think I'd like to thank Dr. Dean as well from Pennsylvania. So they seem to have changed the world order recently, so which is good. So I suppose just I'm a medical microbiologist, so this is like the Olympics for me at the moment, with all these infections happening. And I suppose just a bit of perspective. There's been lots of, I suppose, plagues or pandemics, which are basically diseases that affect the whole world over the past millennia, and that have been documented. And I suppose at the moment, COVID-19 is the big one, but we've had several minor ones with the flu and the Spanish flu and HIV in the last century has been particularly relevant. And a lot of these are viruses, some are bacteria. And so I suppose it's just, it's happened always through history, usually spreads through human contact. And I suppose the fact that we all live in very densely populated groups, so viruses and bacteria and lots of other infectious diseases can spread quite easily. So I just was updating my slides last night, and I think we've gone to 52 million cases worldwide of SARS-CoV or COVID-19. And the deaths have gone up to 1.28 million worldwide. So if you looked at it last week, it was 51 million and probably about 1.1 million deaths. So again, it's still progressing. It's a fairly, nasty disease. And when you talk to any patients who get it, it's definitely not something you want to get. I talked to one colleague last week, and they said it was like getting the influenza by 50. So I just suppose that just puts it in perspective of how bad you feel. And there's a big issue as well with post-COVID syndrome as well, where people get a lot of side effects from the infection itself. So it's not going away for any time soon. So what is COVID-19? And obviously we're all used to these nice little graphics here of the virus. And these are all done by a technique called electron microscopy, which we use in UCC. And it's because the viruses are so small, you can't see them with your naked eye. And the reason why coronavirus is called coronavirus is because when you look at it under an electron microscope, which is about a million times magnification, you see this kind of shape, this pattern here. And this is a false color pattern, and you can see it down here as well. And this is around the virus, okay? And that's the virus particle, and it looks like the corona from the sun. So that's why it's called coronavirus, okay? And as you can see here, down here, these are viruses, taken from infecting a human cell. And then this is a technique that we use in the lab, which we call a plaque assay, which enumerates the virus, because it's very hard to grow the virus, because the virus only grows inside human cells. So it's quite a hard virus to try and study. So we use a lot of techniques called molecular techniques, which allow us then to try and detect the virus, okay? And so you'll have heard of stuff called a spike protein in the virus. And basically the spike protein is this kind of little coat here around the virus. And this spike protein allows the virus to bind to a receptor, which is just a kind of like a sticky molecule on the cells of the lining of your lung called ACE2. And that's how the virus gets in. And then it hijacks our machinery of the cells, and then basically generates lots more virus particles, breaks open the cells, and escapes. And this is the virus here escaping from the cell and infect, and then will proceed to infect more cells. So that's just, I suppose, how you detect it. And I suppose some of the history, what it's about. The name SARS-CoV-2 basically means sudden acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, because there was a SARS-CoV-1 as well about 10 years ago, which mainly affected Asia, kind of Singapore area in particular. So that's why it's called that name. And COVID-19, Ben, is a coronavirus infective disease 19, because it was discovered just at the end of 2019. So that's where these names come from. And a lot of these names obviously are to do with the scientific terminology. And a lot of science is breaking down stuff and trying to find out what's actually happening and trying to categorize these viruses into families so we can understand how they work. Okay, so again, so this is what happens when you get infected. You usually inhale the virus, and then it attacks the epithelial cells, which are the cells that line your mouth and your lungs, and you see them on your hands as well. They're dried out epithelial cells in your hands and in your intestine. And all of these basically, you know, are the barrier function, and underlying it, we have an immune system. And underlying these, you know, the immune system is there to protect in case the barrier function is compromised. And that's what the virus does. It attacks, infects, compromises this barrier, and then the immune system is activated. And the virus then hijacks the immune response to help it disseminate as well by causing extra inflammation. And that's why it's such a nasty disease, okay? And that's why we're trying to understand how that virus works at the moment. And there's been lots of research and probably a lot of confusion for some people as well, because things keep on changing. So this is usually what happens when you do get infected with the virus. It could take anything up to 2 weeks to be infected. That's why you hear about 2 week isolation. So once you get infected with, you know, presented with the virus, then you can take up to 2 weeks to develop symptoms. And a lot of people just get a moderate illness like a flu. Some people get a very severe, and some people get a very nasty illness. And that illness then, you know, can lead to death if they're admitted to ICU because they succumb to other infections as well. So again, this is the problem with the virus, and that's why we need to detect it and understand its immune response, and which I'll discuss from our perspective in UCC in a minute. So, okay, so how does it transmit? Okay, so it's a respiratory virus. So basically it's transmitted by speaking or coughing. And this is a famous photo of somebody sneezing here from MIT. And what you can see here is this is the spread of the virus. And also what happens as well is, like, when you sneeze or you cover your mouth, you can sneeze or cough into your hands, and the virus can survive on your hands. And also the virus will infect our respiratory tract, but also infects our gastrointestinal tract as well. So the virus can be shed in your feces when you go to the bathroom and can aerosolize. And so this is one of the current recommendations, is that you flush the toilet, or you close the toilet seat before you flush. So this is just a graphic here, and this is from just a show from Harpic, who make bleach, and they're just showing how when you flush a toilet, the you aerosolize what you defecate. So just something to be aware of. So mainly respiratory, but it can by hands and also by, I suppose, you know, aerosolization. So that's why you've seen it spread. And this is just a screenshot from the Johns Hopkins tracker site. And you can see these are the accumulated cases since February. And what you can see is, like, where it originated in China, it's under control and there's very little cases. And it now is spread, and it's predominantly, you know, infecting India, Europe, and the Americas. Okay, and you can see here, unfortunately, in America, I think there was 1 million cases in Texas yesterday. So again, a very nasty virus, and it's spread throughout the world apart from Antarctica. I think it's the only place where there's been no coronavirus cases reported. You can see a lot of gaps in the map. Some of these are because there's no population, because that's where it spreads via people, or else there's no reporting. And you can see this is obviously, we're focused on Ireland here. And you'll hear of different terms that you'll come across, quarantine and R0, okay? And if you're, Kellie might say R0, but we hope she doesn't, so it's R0, okay? So quarantine basically comes from the, you know, because we talk about viruses in history, quarantine comes from the Italian for quaranta giorni, which means 40 days. So Venice was a big trading port over the past 500-600 years ago. And so everything was trade was by sea and rivers years ago. And what they noticed is that if a ship came in and somebody was sick, the virus or bacteria infection would spread throughout the city very fast. So what they did was they'd stop people. If there was any infections on the ship, they had to stay moored off the coast of Venice for 40 days. Until the virus or bacteria or whatever was infected basically ran through the ship and had stopped being infective. So that's when you hear quarantine, and then we also hear R0, and that's how infective the virus is. So at the moment, COVID-19 is thought to be 2.5 infective. So if you exposed people to it, roughly, you know, one person, 2.5 people would, you know, roughly, you know, would get sick if you had a look at a group of 15 to 20 people. Okay, another virus such as the measles virus, which we're vaccinated against, is very infective and has a you know, an R0/16, in other words. So most people who would be exposed to the virus would pick it up. Okay, so that's how they gauge the infectivity of viruses. And different ones, influenza, the SARS-CoV-1, and this is why certain viruses were more deadly. Smallpox is very deadly, and measles over the millennia, because it's very infective. So the more exposure, the more infections. Okay, so these are kind of terms that you'll hear in the media, and that's what they're based on. I suppose what's the best way to control the hand sanitizer that you see, and the washing your hands you see advertised, and why is that? Because what you'll see is that the virus has a membrane around it here, and this membrane with the spike protein in it is actually part of the cell coat, which is the normal human cells, and that cell coat then keeps that virus nucleic acid and the virus intact. So when you had on alcohol gel or you wash your hands with soap, what you're doing is you're dissolving that cell coat, which is made out of lipids, which is just fats. So that the alcohol or the detergent in the soap dissolves that. So that's how they work. Masks, while not preventing all transmission, are very useful because they stop that spread of the aerosolization from your when you breathe. Okay, and this is a lovely photograph taken by Dr. Niall Smith in Cork here. And basically they're just able to show that the transmission of the microparticles just by normal breathing versus with a mask on, okay? So these are the recommendations that we all see, okay? And again, don't shake hands, you know, and it's all about trying to get rid of, break that virus coat down, that membrane coat. Obviously, you don't need to do what this man here is telling you, to drink some bleach. Probably won't work, probably just kill you, okay? So again, so these are why these guidelines are recommended, because you can break down that cell membrane coat. Now, I suppose you can see this animation here, and you've heard in the media talks about herd immunity, okay? And you can see this animation working in the background. So herd immunity is based on the theory of having a vaccine. And the more the vaccine, the more vaccinated you are, to reduce the contacts of exposure. So you can see up here where you have zero vaccine, it'll spread, okay? And this is, you know, so you can hear this. So two countries in Europe talk about herd immunity, United Kingdom and Sweden, okay? And if we look at their levels here, you can see that the United Kingdom, these are the levels in April, and then they're increasing up. And then if you looked at Sweden here, where they didn't do any isolation, you can just see the slow increase of numbers the whole time. And this was based on this herd immunity concept, but their herd immunity is flawed if you don't have a vaccine. So this is why it's not working. Okay, and currently, if you use the infective rate, which is R0 of coronavirus, it would take about 29 years to get up to here to 50%. In other words, so people will get infected, but you could reduce the chances. So the concept is completely flawed. And these are two governments that pushed it. And you can see Sweden is escalating quite quickly at the moment, as is the UK. Here in Ireland, we did more of an isolation, and we'll talk about that again in a minute, but you do get spikes, okay? And we can see here we're in a phase 5, which is an isolation at the moment. Okay, so I suppose onto some of the research we're doing here in UCC. What we're doing is we're looking at the nucleic acid or the genomic material of the virus, and then we're able to see how that virus changes as it spreads. And what we can see using the nucleic acids and the sequencing is the technology we use, is that we're able to see that the virus changes slowly between where it starts. So it started here in China, and then it moved to Europe and to America, and you can just see the tracking here. And we can see the virus is slowly changing. Now, it doesn't mutate that fast, so which is good for us, because then it's easier to develop a vaccine for it, okay? And so we can see then there's different ones for specific and, you know, roaming through different continents. So America, North America, is a specific strain with a slight mutation, as is there in Europe, okay? And you can see the Chinese original strain that came from China in Wuhan is now falling off the charts completely, okay? And that's because it's basically the virus has slowly changed, okay? So that's one of the projects we're doing. So we're sequencing all the coronavirus patient samples, and we hope we get a good idea of how the virus changes. And that helps with vaccine discovery and control as well, and detection. Another study we're doing as well with my colleague, Dr. Liam Fanning, is we're looking at the antibody response. So when you get exposed to any infectious agent, be it a bacteria or a virus, you develop an antibody response, okay? And there's two types, an IgM and an IgG. The IgG is your long-lived immunity. And you'll hear a lot of stuff about antibody testing and how antibodies fall off. And basically what happens is, you know, we all develop an antibody to something, And then the longer that antibody persists, the longer you reduce the chance of reinfection. But naturally, viruses, antibodies drop off when they're not being exposed to the virus. So we did a study of 500 healthcare workers in Cork, and we found 100 people who were positive by the SARS-CoV-2 RT-PCR test, which is the test looking for the nucleic acid. And we followed these guys up to 100 days, and we found they have a persisting antibody response. So what you're seeing here basically is this graph here. These little dots are just showing the different tests we use. So we always use several tests to verify rather than relying on one test. And what we can see is the antibody response persists, which is good. It does wane off after about 6 months, but that's normal. Okay, and these are the tests we use, which are made in China. It is rapid, or like a pregnancy test, and it's just a rapid. And this is just a snapshot. We look through all of these, and then we take lots of photos and score them. So again, so it's, you know, it's a, I suppose, short response. And currently, up to 6 months, there's still an antibody response. Now it does drop off slowly, but that's normal. So again, you get a lot of kind of, I suppose, misinformation in the media, so that's a promising result, especially from a vaccine perspective or if you do get sick. We've also been funded, as Amit mentioned, about looking for saliva as a diagnostic. So this is the current way of how we detect the SARS-CoV. We do a thing called a nasopharyngeal swab, and it's like a giant cotton bud goes in through the back here, into your nose, or maybe through your mouth, depending, and they swab the very back here. And what they're doing is, when they're swabbing back here, is they're looking for those epithelial cells that are being lysed by the virus. And then they're looking for the presence of that virus. Okay. Now, again, it's a nasty enough procedure to have. And obviously, this is, somebody put this up on Twitter for Halloween. And so, you know, especially with young kids, you know, it's not a very nice procedure to take. So we're looking for saliva, because the virus targets the epithelial cells, which are also in your mouth, and especially targets the salivary glands. So we believe that saliva could be a good alternative way to test as well, from in the community, rather than having to go get a swab. You could test at home. So we're evaluating that, and all we're going to do is just send people these tubes with a preservative finish, which lyses the virus, in other words, makes it ineffective, and then we can process it in the lab and look for detection of the virus by the standard method. So that's one of the things we're doing at the moment, and it looks like it's quite promising. There's other initiatives in America have used it as well, and they're finding it as good as the nasopharyngeal swab, and probably not as traumatic. And talking to one colleague who got it, they said, you only know it works when you start crying afterwards. So that's not enjoyable. So, and then we're also looking as well, I mentioned about shedding the virus in your, when you go to the bathroom or when you defecate. So a colleague, Niall O'Leary in microbiology here, what we're looking at is to see if we can detect the virus in sewage. So if you can detect the virus in sewage, then what you can do is you can detect if it's in the community. So rather than sampling everyone, you could test just in the in sampling points, in sewage sampling points before processing. Or even in Ireland, unfortunately, we have some raw sewage being discharged into the sea at several points here. And this is just from the Irish Times today. And so we can sample these, and then you can be able to then to see if you can detect the virus, and then you know whether it's in the community as well. So it could be a good way of looking for community infection. So this is ongoing at the moment, and we're hoping we get any virus in the sewage, really, because then we know it's been treated correctly. So I suppose then, just to kind of wrap up, really, you've heard a lot about vaccines at the moment, and, you know, this RNA vaccine and different vaccines that are designed for the virus. Basically, what people are designing, like protein that we all hear about, are parts of the virus, such as the RNA, which is the nucleic acid, which is the instruction to build the virus, and also looking for different parts, which are the coats of the virus. And these then will generate an immune response. So currently, you've seen in the media about the Pfizer vaccine, and it's an RNA vaccine. And what it does is that this vaccine basically is injecting the nucleic acid from the virus, and when people take it up, and then your body, the nucleic acid gets into your cells, and your body makes the spike protein, and your body recognizes the spike protein as being foreign and develops an antibody response. Okay, so that's how the current vaccine, that's what that's targeting, and that will generate an immune response. Now, like all vaccines, they're all works in progress, and some of them have strengths and some of them are weaknesses. So the current one is an RNA vaccine, and that's the instruction material. However, that's very unstable. And because of it needs to be preserved. So if you shipped the RNA vaccine that Pfizer using, it has to be at minus 80 degrees. So for long-term storage and stability, it'd have to be always kept at below minus 20. So again, that's going to be a logistical issue with that vaccine. So while it might be beneficial, the whole delivery of the vaccine may be problematic. So again, so that's one of the ones, so that's an RNA vaccine. Generally, the vaccines that we see with influenza are where we grow up the virus and we inactivate it with a UV light and we inject the whole virus that's inactivated in. Okay, so some of these are coming through too, but again, it's slow because there's so many regulations to make sure that they're very safe. Okay, so I suppose then just to wrap up, I suppose, what's the outlook? Okay, so we'll be waiting for our vaccines because we have to go through regulatory procedures. So, and the slides, of course, you have Dr. Philip Povell here at UCC, who's a mathematical modeler. And basically, they look at epidemic data and outbreaks. And basically, what he's showing here in this graph, without confusing you too much, is looking at infection. And then, I suppose, the death rate and the accumulated rates of detection. And this is with isolation. And so then this is when we have phase five, which we're in now, where everything's shut down apart from kind of grocery stores. And, you know, I suppose just you can go to work, but you have to wear masks. And this is where we're kind of at the moment. And so what's happening is once you release these isolation phases, which different countries have different ones, then you get an increase in the virus detection. So a good example would be in Ireland here. This is the start of the coronavirus detection in Ireland, just at the end of February, start of March, and then it peaked. And then it dropped off then during the summer. But then we see again another peak, we started noticing it, detection levels in September. But if we go back and look at the curves and look at the data accumulation, in late July, start of August is when it started slowly accumulating. And so this is what happened. So that's when the phases of isolation had reduced. So in June and July, the phases of isolation had reduced. And then we saw that plateauing or lack of detection because of the isolation phases. But unfortunately, once you give the isolation phases, once they're reduced and people go back to normal behavior, slowly the virus introduces and starts creeping back up again. And you get these spikes. And this is, again, you can see here, this is where they started introducing again in around the end of October in Ireland. They introduced phase five isolation. And we can see then it started dropping down and it'll keep on dropping. And once we release the phase of isolation, it'll come back up again. And you'll see this peaks happening. And that's just the way the virus spreads in the community. So we're going to see these phases of peaks and troughs with the virus until we can either break that phase. And the only way to break that phase is by increasing screening to isolate people, or else you have a vaccine. And, you know, and so that's one of the big things. And you can see here, these are different countries who've controlled the virus quite well. You can see in South Korea here, they had a spike and they introduced lockdown, another spike. And then you can see it always happening, the spike, and then the lockdown starts. Okay. And you can see this is just Ireland here. And obviously then this is in Singapore, they had a spike and they had a big lockdown. And then it trickled away at low numbers. And then they released the phases and then it spiked up again. Okay. And you can see again, it's starting to increase slowly in South Korea again. So again, so this is just what's happening. It's normal because there's no vaccine. Okay. And then we just show our friend the mink at the moment here. And so in the media, you'll see a lot about the mink. And really what's happening with the mink is that the virus has jumped from humans into the mink, and these mink are intensively farmed for their fur coats, and the virus is mutated. And why it is a big issue is because the mutation is in the spike protein. So in other words, the vaccine that's been designed, if that mutation gets in, perhaps that virus, that the mink protein, the mink virus may jump to humans because it jumped from humans to mink. And then the vaccine may be ineffective because the spike protein has changed. And that's why it's in the media at the moment. And that's why it's a concern. Okay, so thanks very much. And I'll just stop sharing there. So. Okay, so should let me stop. Okay. Just trying to stop sharing, sorry. No, thanks very much. And I'll hand you over to Dr. Kellie Dean.
OK, Welcome everyone, and thanks for joining us. And thanks to my colleague, Dr. John McSharry, for a really informative talk. And I'm going to touch on some of the things that he highlighted. And my session is more a kind of a personal journey of why you should do science. Why is science so important? So I'm focusing on the importance of health and life sciences in the new COVID world. And John has really highlighted a lot of the issues that we are facing. COVID is a massive challenge. It wasn't, I suppose, unexpected, but we are faced with a lot of different problems. And what I would say is that I'm really of the belief that science is the solution. And I think John's talk really pointed out the different areas. It involves biologists, it involves mathematicians, it involves environmental scientists, if we're going to start looking at wastewater and, you know, kind of really considering all the different aspects that COVID has really presented with us. So I wanted to talk about my own personal science journey, which, as Amit mentioned, I grew up in Western Pennsylvania, and I always really liked science. I didn't really know exactly what I wanted to do, I suppose, like many students. And when I started at university, I thought, I mean, I remember sitting on my bed, kind of at home, picking course, like, what would I do in college? And I thought, oh, you know, I kind of like lab. I want to work in a lab. And I put down as a course choice, which is called in Ireland, biomedical science and medical technology was the course name. And so I went off to college, and this is a personal slide of where I've been. So I started off here at Indiana University of Pennsylvania. This is the science building, Wyant Hall. And I essentially started off in medical technology, doing lots of biology, cell biology, a little bit of math, not too much, some physics, bits and pieces. And then in the third year of the degree, I took biochemistry as a course. And that's been it. That's all I've ever done since. It totally changed my life. And I can honestly say, like, this window right here was the lab that I worked in. I had a professor, Richard Hartline, for biochemistry. I can honestly say I worked so hard in the class, but I was determined. And it was through his encouragement that I applied for a summer research position. It was through his encouragement that I ended up switching out of medical technology and biomed science and became moved into chemistry. The reason being is that he saw something in me that maybe I didn't even know I had. I kind of had this idea like, oh, you know, maybe I wanted to teach at a college. And I started to, after the research experience, started to question what I was doing. And I think what I had to sign up for a particular class, and I sort of had this realization that maybe I didn't want to work in a lab in a hospital and take blood from people. And I totally switched gears and decided, oh, wouldn't it be good to go to do a PhD or teach at a college? And I didn't even know what a PhD was about then. And it was really through his encouragement, I switched my degree to chemistry, thinking, because I essentially needed to take physical chemistry before I would go for a biochemistry degree. And he told me that. He said, you know, you may as well take physical chemistry here. It'll be a lot easier. And I switched my degree in my third year of college. It added an entire year onto my degree because I had to go back and get lots of other classes to actually finish. So I ended up doing research in this lab, and I went straight then to a PhD in biochemistry and biophysics at the University of Chapel Hill. So that's the picture over here. And again, I kind of came in with this idea that I'd work on receptors and things like ACE2 that John mentioned that are on human cells and what the receptors are doing. And that's kind of what I thought I would do. And again, it was through teachers that I met that I totally became immersed in RNA. Now, John's already presented you a nice story about SARS-CoV-2 because that virus is an RNA nucleic acid virus. So the nucleic acid, the instructions that cause the virus to make more virus, is an RNA molecule. And I'm just showing you a picture of what these funny RNA molecules look like. This is from my own lab now. And they have these wild structures, and the SARS-CoV-2 virus has an RNA molecule sitting in the inside of it. And that's what we're using to test to see whether the virus is present or not. So it was at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill that I started working on RNA and RNA binding proteins. And it is something that I have never given up. My PhD was on that. I then went for essentially to follow on after a PhD. Usually you do another research position called a postdoctoral position. And I did 1 year in University of Heidelberg in Germany, kind of a continuation of what I was working on at North Carolina. And during that time, I had a brilliant time, worked very, very hard in University of Heidelberg. And my boss there is now a director of a Max Planck Institute in Germany. So he's moved up and on. And during that time, I was interviewing for, because I knew that was short term, I interviewed and went back to what is over here, which is Duke University. In Durham, North Carolina. This was a position, a full 5 year position as a postdoc with the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, again studying RNA and RNA binding proteins. So that was a brilliant time. And during my time in Heidelberg, it's like, how did I end up in Ireland? I actually met my husband in Germany. He moved to America, and then we both moved to Ireland and came to UCC in 2005. And as Emmett said, initially I kind of didn't know what I was going to be doing at UCC. And I interviewed for a position and I didn't get it. And I kept talking to people and I'm like, I kind of had this idea I wanted to teach. And it was really through talking to people that I got a position teaching part-time, and it was in Medicine One. Medicine One was my first assignment. I arrived in Ireland on a Saturday, and Monday morning, 2 days later, I was in front of Medicine One in Brookfield, which is one of the buildings on campus. So it's been a wild journey since then. So I did the part-time teaching for about 3 years, and part of my teaching portfolio then was Dental One students, which I still teach. I always have taught Dental One, and Dr. McSharry's saliva test is of particular interest to me because I teach a whole lecture on saliva diagnostics. So I need to get you in with your tubes and show the dental students when we're back, and you can do a co-lecture with me. That'd be super. So after 3 years of part-time teaching, I then became director of a full-time PhD program in cancer biology. And what you're seeing down here on the right is an immunofluorescent image. This is an actual cancer cell that we have stained with different labels so you can see the actual structure of it. So through training students in cancer biology, I began to become interested in cancer and kind of research topics. And then in 2015, I finally obtained, after interviewing and a long process, a full-time lectureship where I essentially combined my interest of RNA with cancer. And so now we study these non-coding, stroke coding, long non-coding RNAs. Here, this is a picture of one. We do things similar to the work that Dr. McSharry is doing with SARS-CoV-2. We're looking across lots of different cells and looking at lots of different RNAs and trying to understand how well they're expressed in different cells. So here you're seeing, this is from a new PhD student in the lab, and these are non-coding RNAs across different breast cancer cell lines. And I would have to say, initially at the start, I'm the first one in my family that ever went to college. I'm a first gen college graduate, as they call it. No one in my family has a PhD, and this all was, kind of new. But I think, if you're considering a career in science, what has helped me are I've had great mentors and great teachers. So really, without them, I wouldn't be here. I really do believe that, they've opened opportunities for me and maybe saw things in me that I didn't know I could do. Because there were plenty of times that I was uncertain. And one time in North Carolina, I was like, I am done. I am not doing this PhD. I marched into the office of my supervisor and I'm like, well, I'm quitting. That's it. So, and then things turned around. Why did they turn around? Is because things that you need in science is that you have to be persistent. You have to be resilient. You have to be creative. And those aspects you develop through your course and through experience. And those are things that your teachers can help you with. I think there are so many brilliant people at UCC. And when I saw that John got funding from the SFI for his saliva test, I wrote to him right away. And I was like, you absolutely have to come and we have to work together. So have to speak to my dental students. I really do believe that science is a solution, and it's really about all different kinds of science. It's not, I'm totally focused and immersed in RNA and cancer biology at the minute, and biochemistry, and I always have been, but I started off in chemistry. I had to do lots of physics. I had to do mathematics as well. I liked it. I actually was really good at it. It's kind of, I don't use it in my day-to-day job as much as probably I need, I could. But if you have a solid grounding in science subjects, the world is open to you. You can see from my own career progression, I was in the US, I went to Germany, went back to the US, I came to Ireland. If you learn science and how to think critically, solve problems, and you have these kind of this insane curiosity about stuff, and kind of persistence and resilience, and you have a little creative aspect to what you're doing, you will do well in science. So thank you for listening. That is kind of my personal take on a science career. And you can see from, I didn't focus so much on the research, but you can see from the research that Dr. McSharry presented that you can see all these elements working through. Our current challenge, which is this pandemic. This is one of many challenges that the world is facing, the climate crisis that we're facing. Again, I truly believe that science is a solution. I wish you all the best in your choices and your scientific careers, but please do consider us because there are great, great people at UCC. And as I said, you need great teachers to build you up so you can really tackle these problems. All right, thanks so much. Stop sharing.
I think great insights, one, Dr. Kelly, your journey from where you started to where you are today, and the interest in science. And I think whatever people may say, the solutions will only come through science, so that remains a reality and truth, so no two ways about it. Whenever we'll have the right vaccine or any medicine, I think it'll be through science only. There's no other way. Dr. Sherry, I think the comments you made today on the vaccine, which is likely to come in, which is in news of late, and others which were earlier in news and may possibly see some action, if I say so, in times to come. I think you'll be the best judge to gauge the effectiveness of these vaccines and medicines. Just out of curiosity, I think every other citizen in the world is possibly trying to get some answers from people, and I have the privilege to have two of you today. If Dr. Sherry, you can comment, you know, from your experience, which is going to be the vaccine, the AstraZeneca's or the Pfizer's or Moderna's, or, you know, everyone is taking their chance. There, you know, a lot going around the market.
I suppose the Pfizer one is the closest to coming out, which is the RNA base, which is, as Kellie said, is the key to all of these viruses reproducing. But like everything, and I know scientists are very cynical, but there's a caveat, you know, and, you know, again, it's very unstable for transport around people. So that's something to think about. So at the moment, Pfizer is the closest, but how you get a virus that needs to be stored and, you know, a frozen to, you know, somewhere that you'd have to follow a cold chain from maybe a supermarket, or, you know, because your general medical practice won't have a minus 80 clinic, you know, or minus 20, literally, you know, so that's going to be a logistical issue. The flu vaccine is quite useful because it's stable at room temperature and just inactivated virus particle. That the coronavirus, you know, the SARS-CoV-2 version of that is, you know, is another year away, I would say.
Yeah, because given a country like India, it is going to be a logistical nightmare to even think of reaching even 10% of the people with the kind of requirements or the prerequisites to get this thing moving.
Yeah, like that's the big risk, you know, and like all of these infections, you know, you don't know how good a virus vaccine is going to work. So several vaccines at the moment, say hepatitis B vaccine, it does induce immunity, but you need to get boosters. And some of the boosters, you know, so some of them are more frequent, some of them, you know, are long lived, and that's all, you know, what's ahead of us. And, you know, as like, it's all down to the research, you know, as Kellie was saying, you know, you have to try and understand the research, but also the logistics behind all of that then is going to make it harder. So the reason why we don't have these vaccines, or, you know, why every country in the world is suffering, is because, unfortunately, our governments don't fund research and medicine linked together. So what you need is to be able to fund the basic research to understand how something works, and then have the medical facilities up to speed to say, okay, we can use this right now. So for instance, the technique they're using to detect the virus, this RT-PCR, which detects the RNA, which Kellie talked about, that technique's only been accepted in the medical community in maybe the last 5-10 years. We've been doing that since probably, you know, 1990, you know. So it's, you know, it's the change of pace, and it's to do with the funding models, you know. Unfortunately, we talk about, you know, all of these things like the Googles and the Amazons and the Apples. That's where they should be putting their money, because it'll translate into benefit for everyone, you know. Like the outcome is debt if we don't have enough. And that's why there were so many deaths at the start, because of all these elderly people.
Just one thing which you said, Darren, as you mentioned, it may need some boosters as we go along. So it seems like Corona is going to be with us for a very, very long time now.
Yeah.
I unfortunately will agree. And I mean, John is exactly right, because we study RNA in the lab, and essentially as soon as we make any RNA molecule, it goes into minus 80 degrees C. These are massive freezers. They take a huge amount of energy to run them and keep them cold. It is not practical to immunize the global population with something as effective as it might be for a certain population. So we need lots of solutions. We don't need, it's not going to be just one. And there's a race. I mean, I can honestly say, I mean, maybe this is forced everybody to really work together and share information. There is so much, we know so much about this virus so quickly because there's been a concerted effort by scientists and mathematicians and modelers and everything working together. And that's what it's going to take. It's going to take working together and find solutions that are useful for everybody. Not, a certain population that has access to a minus 80 and a fancy PCR equipment. So there's a lot to be done. There's a lot to be done.
Dr. Lee, one thing which brings me to you, will it have any vaccine which will come out whenever it happens? You think the weather conditions, for example, Southeast Asia or South Asian countries are pretty warm in a way than other European countries. Here the temperatures are up to 50 degrees Celsius. So you think the vaccine which Pfizer is likely to come out with will have a chance to survive, or will need a different vaccine here?
I think there's going to have to be different options, unless they can somehow stabilize what they have and make it, that it doesn't have this requirement of being at minus 80 degrees. I mean, I can just tell you in my own lab, that's every RNA we make, it goes straight into minus 80. So then that becomes a pro like how do you get the thing stable at the various conditions that are actually going to allow it to be delivered? So there's a lot. I mean, this is true of any medicine, to be honest. It doesn't matter how brilliant the medicine is, as if it can't get to the people that need it. There's a whole different, those are different problems. And it's not just delivery externally in the environment, but even when I take it, am I going to have to inject it? Am I going to have to take a tablet? Am I going to have and mode of delivery and actually getting to the site that needs the medicine, those are problems as well that need to be solved, again, by scientists and mathematicians and understanding the biology to really fund that. We need to know more in order to solve these problems. So I'm hopeful. There are a couple companies doing RNA vaccines, and so far preliminary data is okay. But there are loads of other options as well. Like John was talking about the spike protein and really understanding that spike protein and understanding where it's attacking cells. So it could be medicines as well. It could be not just a vaccine, but a whole arsenal of vaccine therapeutics, plus all the social distancing, hand washing, sanitizing, mask wearing, all of that matters too. It's not just the vaccine's not going to make it all disappear, unfortunately, I don't think. Maybe I'm hopeful though. I'm hopeful.
No, it's been a very, very long time. We all are deprived of meeting people, shaking hands, travel, eating out, and I don't think it's going to be coming to reality sometime soon. So, Dr. Sherry, anything you would like to share on what Dr. Kelly was mentioning on the distribution and the acceptability on different humans around the world who live in different environments?
Yeah, so again, it's the logistics, and I think, unfortunately, isolation and quarantine and masks are here to with it, are here with us for another year at least, I would say. It is combinations of different therapies. Like, unfortunately, we're all used to having instant access and instant solutions with our looking up our phone, getting data to, I want to do something. So, 40 years ago, you didn't have the internet. You didn't
By
get a lot of
Google.
information. And so again, it's all about we need a combination, but we need to educate people as well. That, you know, if you're sick, you should stay at home. You know, it's that easy. Just stay at home. Your home is fine. It's not hell. It's not like you're somewhere you can't go. You can go at home and relax and recover. And we've all experienced it where, you know, you have a colleague and they're sneezing and coughing and they're going, I'm okay. I don't want to lose a sick day because I'm going away on holidays in 2 weeks' time. So, you know, so that's the mentality you need to change, is if you have a symptom or if you're sick, you stay at home. You know, you're not going to get a medal for going in and making other people sick. And it's what we need to do as well. We need to change our perception of expecting something to happen for us. We need to take responsibility ourselves, you know.
Very, very insightful. Thank you so very much, Dr. John McSharry and Dr. Kellie Dean, for this detailed discussion and understanding on this very interesting topic, which is, of course, the need of the hour. And I'm sure students will benefit from your talk, and this is going to generate and garner more interest in the topic you spoke about in UCC as an institution. And we are always greedy to come back to speakers like you to have more and more insight on such subjects and topics. So hopefully we'll be able to have you both on another discussion sometime soon to take some interesting messages and some insights on another interesting topic to our audiences. Thank you again for your time, and thank you again for your insights. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. Hope to see you in person.
Thanks very much. Thank you. Yeah, sometime. Thanks very much, Amit.
Thank you, Jocelyn and Brady.